Mullaney from Richmond, Virginia, and I'm an anarchist. And today, I'm here at the Compass once more to spread the message of freedom. Just as a reminder, this Friday there's going to be another Freedom Gathering, the Freedom Gathering of September. And I mean, this is a place where, you know, there's a potluck, freedom discussion, or an after party. Sometimes our friends come with their fire magic and our local fire masters here in RVA. But at the same time, it's a place to also bring your, I guess, new friends that have yet to understand what anarchy is. You know, also if you have questions and how a free and voluntary society would work, this is the place to be. You know, so it's a community center, a learning center. You know, also for anybody who's kind of passing through to Richmond or RVA along the East Coast, you always have a place to stay. You know, we now have two anarchy gardens that's open for for more anarchy for ending the state, and that's the Maplewood Anarchy Garden and the Nevermore Anarchy Garden. So this Friday is going to take place at the Nevermore. So anyone who's interested in a free and voluntary society and ending the state and any taxation and regulation in any way that these arbitrary strangers called politicians forces their ideas and preferences upon you, you're more than welcome to come. So definitely please bring your friends, bring anyone who's interested in freedom. So with that, hopefully you enjoy the content. Please share and subscribe, and I'll see you at the Victory Party. Take good care. Without the state, all right, so that's, a great question. So without the state, very interesting to consider, because the thing is, without the state, without a government, there's no such thing as a corporation. Okay. All a corporation is it's a piece of paper that allows the person to escape personal liability, right? LLCs, limited liability corporations, right? Mm-hmm. So you have like the CEO off the coast of Alaska that caused that oil spill off of there. He didn't go to jail, he didn't lose his money, he didn't lose his house, he didn't lose anything. Mm-hmm. He was able to mitigate those costs by lowering employee salaries, by increasing consumer prices. That's how they put off the cost to everyone else, because they're not held liable.
Right.
So without a government, they don't have those pieces and papers backed and enforced by the monopolized violence. So it goes back to the way it used to be, where actually people actually were held responsible and liable for their own actions and for the product that they create and the outcomes of that product. So no corporations, a real free market that's never actually been seen. Like, what did you study here? Like for
biology.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. So biology is interesting. So you can find a very interesting niche for, like, it looked like cheetahs, for example, right? So cheetahs have a problem reproducing because there's not a variety of different kinds of cheetahs that they can mate with today. There was some kind of a bottleneck effect that happened, you know, centuries ago, and because of that, a lot of different cheetahs have died out. There's only one specific species of cheetahs. So because they don't have the ability to mate with other cheetahs, you know, have the competition of that, or those genetic variations, has caused a delineation of that particular gene. You know, it's hard for them to reproduce, to have a lot of health problems, and that's pretty much what you find whenever the state controls the market. No freedom of competition, quality always goes down. Whereas if you have a freedom of competition, like before that bottleneck effect, you know, things are actually good. You know, good genes, intermingling, more of the quality keeps continuing to rise.
So how do you make sure that it's a perfect free market for, for example, like things like how would research get funded?
Okay.
How do you make sure that voting for your dollar is really, that the dollar represents, that it can represent all value?
All right, so research and development. All right, that's a very good question. For the most part, the government doesn't really produce anything. They already outsource that to businesses to do, right? Like Boeing or... government doesn't build roads, for example. They outsource it to business to build. Raytheon, for example, you look at research and development businesses are actually who take that money and actually create the research to begin with. Right? So in effect, what you'll find then, government is that middleman, would-be mugger, that best distributes your money and how they feel how it should be, right? So you don't really have a choice. It's like, well, you know what, that's kind of useless. You know, that's not where I want my money to go. So you'll be able to very much direct it in where you would want it to go directly. Much like somebody starting a Kickstarter campaign, right?
Mm-hmm.
I have a great idea, you know, actually going out there and asking for funding, asking for crowdsourcing. But unfortunately, what government does is, regardless of what your thoughts and opinions are, their ideas are backed by violence, right? Their ideas is backed through that theft. So you can look at the Wright brothers, for example. So the Wright brothers created this plane for like, what, $2,000? Very bare minimum. They were building these planes off of like, their bike shop that they had. And so after, and their only competition was the United States government. They had tens of thousands of dollars. They were trying to compete in creating this plane also. But the Wright brothers did it in a small amount of money because, you know, this is their money. This is their productivity. This is something they had to create.
Right.
So they have a better, more niche and understanding how best to appropriate it. Chris, you have somebody who's like, you know, people just throwing money at you. You can make a lot of mistakes and error. It doesn't matter because you know that there'll always be taxation, there'll always be funding. So the Wright brothers was able to beat, out-compete the U.S. government in creating the plane. But the thing is, the only reason you don't hear about like new awesome inventions that the Wright brothers did after that is because they got embroiled in intellectual property lawsuits with the United States. So you see, like intellectual property wouldn't exist. You know, it'd be it's not a real tangible product. It's not a scarce commodity, for example. So you'll find like these trappings that the government created also restricted and kind of stifled new innovations that could have arisen from the Wright brothers, you know? Like what else could they have created, right? This is the same stuff that got that held back Tesla, you know, with the patent lawsuits, with Edison having political favor from the government, able to outcompete and force him out of business. So without a government, there's no one to bribe, there's no corporation, you know, it's at your own merits.
Right. Cool. Yeah. What group are you with?
All right, so I'm with Liberate RVA. It's a non-political organization. Just pretty much trying to turn to our community and turn away from government. You know, we don't use violence to solve our lives, to solve the problems in our lives. So let's use that, right? Let's turn to our community towards that versus what government only knows how to do. Oh yeah, we have pamphlets, anarchy pamphlet and peaceful parenthood pamphlet.
Cool.
We're having a freedom gathering this Friday, potluck, freedom discussion, an after party, but pretty much for me, I don't know, that's the direction where it has to go, you know? I'm not ascribing for utopia. You know, utopia for me just means stagnation and idleness. I want there to always be problems, but at least ways to keep improving upon those situations and upon that product or service in that direction that's founded on nonviolent principles.
Cool.
Yeah?
Are you guys making a video?
Yeah, so this is on YouTube, so I make a lot of pretty much little small interviews here on campus and talk about people about anarchy. And so pretty much everybody agrees. And so for the most part, like sometimes there's like one little question that people have, like how is anyone else gonna see this? Mm-hmm. I was like, well, that's, all right, if that's really the only question you have, that's great, because you'll find that there's a lot of people already agree upon this. I mean, you're already, you know, the fact that you don't use violence to solve your problems already says that you already have a hold of this principle, right? Kind of in the same way, like, once everyone becomes an abolitionist, eventually that word and meaning goes away, right? Mm-hmm. So this, the labeling and the and anarchy in a free and voluntary society, once everyone becomes an anarchist, eventually that word and meaning will go away. But eventually, again, like with that agriculture situation over 100 years ago, I don't know what it's going to look like outside of this institutional violence, but it's going to look so much better and different than what we have today. You know, maybe finally we'll be able to get off this rock, you know? I saw the monopolization of the space programs NASA has, and you know, they're already having a lot of budget cuts because it becomes unsustainable.
Cool.
Yeah, well, my name is Cal.
Nice to meet you.
You as well. You as well.
Yeah, have a good day.
You too, man.
See if any of your friends want to come too.
Okay, I'll see.
Hey.
Okay.
You curious?
How's the government in the world?
Great question, man. All right, I'm going to ask you three simple questions. Okay. And then very briefly discuss the hidden violence beyond government and just ask what your thoughts and comments are.
Okay.
Sounds good? All right. First question. In your day-to-day life, do you use violence to solve your personal problems?
Are we thinking like hand-to-hand violence?
All right, so let's define violence. Very important to define definition terms. Violence defined as placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent or choice, i.e. rape, murder, theft, and assault.
Okay.
Like boxing as an outlet of aggression, they have rules though, right?
Sure.
Nothing below the waist, no ear body, Mike Tyson.
Sure.
And then we can box, right? So then with that definition, would you say that you use violence in your day-to-day life to solve problems?
Daily, no.
Daily. Okay, great. And so the question is not have you ever.
Right.
And so the second question would be, with the exception of self-defense, of yourself and others, would you consider it wrong and immoral to initiate that violence?
Depends on the circumstance.
Circumstances of self-defense? Of yourself and others?
Right, but the problem with that is that you can make the argument towards a lot of different situations being self-defense.
Well, self-defense from the initiation of that violence. Self-defense from someone being assaulted. Self-defense from someone being raped. Self-defense from someone being robbed. Self-defense from someone being...
Right, but then where is that line drawn?
Well,
who decides where that ethical moral is? Ethical line is drawn?
That's a great question.
So are they only defending... It's only moral if we're defending the individual?
Yeah, because you're resisting
what about
the...
groups of people?
What about
groups
of people?
What groups of people are allowed to be defended against, and then that's included in
self-defense. Right, but you can't show me a group without showing me individual people, because only individual people exist. So it's on the individual basis. So let's go bring back to the individual. So self-defense of yourself and others is self-preservation of your own. I mean, property rights.
So acting in that violence in an instance which is not provoked by the need to defend someone who is in need?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Then yes, that would be immoral.
Sure. And then would you also consider it wrong and immoral to violently force your ideas onto other people?
Yes.
Perfect. Versus like rational discussion or persuasion or
sure.
You may not like what I have to say, but you could ignore me, ostracize me, walk away, right?
Sure.
Perfect. So you just tell me then your day-to-day life, you have a plurality of nonviolent solutions you apply and use.
Sure.
And you have this more integrity then against that violence. And as a community of people here, individual people here in Richmond though, we're taught that the only way we can affect any kind of change and make any kind of difference though is through government.
Sure.
And they tell us the only way to do it is to vote.
Sure.
So people vote with their ideas and opinions and preferences and how best to solve that problem and in effect elect a politician. That politician, his or her only job is to legislate those ideas and opinions into law.
Sure.
And then those laws of opinions are then backed and enforced by the police at gunpoint. You could take cannabis, for example. And if I were to smoke a plant, I would be kidnapped, arrested, thrown into a cage, a prison, in which at any point I refuse or resist or don't agree with that opinion and try to escape, I would be met with more violence and sometimes shot, murdered. And at the same time, government is even falling into more violence because at no point can you say, I do want to help the poor, but I don't want to fund war. Right? You still do not have a freedom of economic choice. You still have to give government your money. You still have to give government your property. You still have to pay your taxes. Because if you did have a freedom of economic choice, they wouldn't threaten to send you to another cage if you didn't pay your taxes, right? And that's the hidden violence behind this matrix behind government, that this organization only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve many problems versus the plurality of nonviolent solutions that you and I already share.
Well, the problem is that it's the easiest way to do it.
Right. Yeah, yeah. So violence has...
It's the simplest way to govern a mass group of people.
Great. All right. No, you got there. Okay. So, like, for example, violence has an interesting short-term effect in trying to get those results, but there's the hidden consequences of that are long-term.
Well, it remains to be effective because they can hide a veil of ignorance.
Right.
Amongst the people, and it can be masked fairly easily.
Yeah, like the Social Security. Before sure. you were born, they forced that service before you, but in the beginning, and they pass that out to people, they'll say, look, it's only going to cost this much this year, right?
Sure.
Of course, the politician that's kind of peddling that out there, he's not going to be around, you know, several decades later. Sure. And then the true cost is finally revealed generations later, you know, that you and I won't ever have that.
Sure.
We'll never live old enough to see that. But that's a forced service. But then that's what government is. They have a monopolization on services. They have a monopoly on law. They have a monopoly on security, on judges, on courts, on roads, on even currency, even first-class mail.
But does the blame really go on government, or does the blame go on us as the people? Because we're the ones who are technically with the system that are allowing them to do all this. And by us not voting strongly enough, or rioting strongly enough, or rising up strongly enough,
right.
It's us kind of saying, okay, well, we're okay with that.
Well, okay, I can see that.
Yeah.
But the thing is, this was put in place before you were born, that you were
sure.
not giving consent, right?
Sure.
Like, if I'm going to draw up a contract 300 years ago, you cannot, it's wrong and immoral to force that onto the unborn, right?
So we want to go to Thomas Jefferson's idea of each generation drafting their own constitution.
Their own contract.
Sure.
A real tangible contract, an explicit contract, like a mortgage contract or a car contract, a contract with Geico, real rules and consequences that you can agree to. Right?
Sure.
So the point of all this, I'm trying to say that this moral position that you and I already share against using violence to solve problems, that's called anarchy.
Sure.
Like in science, anons and panons, ans mean without, archy means rulers. Like monarchy, one political ruler, anarchy means without political rulers.
Sure.
So we can still have rules, we can still have a polycentric legal system, we can still have private dispute resolution organizations that must already exist today, like on eBay, on pretty much Geico, for example, but outside of the monopoly on law, outside of the monopoly on security on judges that, will arbitrary dictate, sorry, I don't like what you're wearing, contempt of court, right? You're not standing up and calling me your honor, contempt of court, right?
Sure.
But you're still paying for that salary. But at least in a free and voluntary society, you can choose, right? And then it'll be them catering to your needs, them catering to you as the consumer. Because then you have the freedom to unsubscribe, cancel payment, or have the freedom to compete and provide a better service that's not going to be abusive and harmful to the consumers.
Right, but with that type of system, what you lose is the peace of mind with the illusion of the system. That would be the... Well, because my thought is when you tell the average group of people that idea, their immediate thought, even if you can take them through the logical thought progression and you can actually place them, and so they're trying to emotionally predict how they would feel in that situation, I think one of the first things that be thought of is, oh, well, that's incredibly uncomfortable. I wake up in the morning and I don't know that, you know, the police force is there to protect me. I'm not waking up in the morning knowing that there are these boundaries and these rules that everyone else has to follow so that I will be safe.
Right.
When really that, I guess you can argue that it's really just an illusion, because how safe are we really?
Yeah.
But it's really that illusion of peace of mind.
That already occurs right now, right?
Right. Yeah.
Right. Right. But at least now you're...
The average American, though, is going to look at that and be like, oh, no, that's our protection.
Right.
But
And the government has done a great job in creating that illusion and that curtain to think that they're here to protect our freedom and our property. Now, at any moment, they can claim, manifest destiny, eminent domain, and take your property. At any moment, they could pass a regulation, a law that you didn't agree upon because you didn't have a majority, and they force their preference onto you. The greatest evil for the minority, but the greatest good for the majority, greatest evil for the minority.
Sure.
Right?
I guess the question becomes, what price do you pay for your peace of mind?
The price would be having the courage to stand up for what's good, having the courage to stand up against what's here, right? I mean, if 40-50% of your income already stolen, you know, people talk about limited government, that was called 1776. Look where we are today. That one exception for government allowed it to continue to increase in size until the Leviathan size where it is today, where over 1 million people are now thrown into cages more than any other government in the world.
Sure.
75% of them for victimless crimes.
If our population wasn't so large, then that probably couldn't have been masked so easily.
All right,
then there probably would be more outrage.
Right, well, you see there's populations in government of China have more population than the United States in the billions, but still we have more prisoners than them. India, the same thing, but more prisoners than them. Is this because of different ways that the political rulers can create this arbitrary laws that only apply to us tax slaves? And that's what they're really trying to find, because the thing is unsustainable. Over 97% of the value of the dollar has already lost its value. It's got 3% left to go before we're rolling around with like wheelbarrows of marks in World War II. And that's what happens when you have a monopoly on anything. The cost continues to rise and the quality continues to depreciate because there's no freedom of competition. And because of that, so you'll find that, I guess, not outside of the currency, but that hurts the poor the worst, right? I mean, there's no incentive to save or no incentive to kind of hold any of this money because it's just going to keep continuing to depreciate in value.
Sure.
Especially when you're on a tight budget to begin with. So outside of the government, though, at least the safety and the comfort would be that this business that you're paying for is providing you what matches your preference best, right? And what government's trying to do is they're trying to say that you don't know how best to decide a business product or service to match your preference. That's what they're trying to say, right? So that's what we like, you know? Like, again, agriculture didn't look like the same like 100 years ago when there was an institution of violence and slavery, but when they ended that, we have free market solutions. You can't tell the same farmers how it's going to look like 100 years from now. It's like they can't even begin to imagine, right? But in the same way, when you end this institution of violence, I'm not sure how it's going to look like, but it's going to look a lot better than what we have today. Real freedom of choice, real freedom of economic choice.
Yeah, I mean, the main fear I would have is immediately, the immediate impact would be completely disastrous. The first wave of, okay, well now, here you go, everything's gone. All your rules, all your boundaries, go do whatever you want. I mean, things would certainly settle after the chaos.
Order. Yeah.
But
that's a good point.
That's what would happen first.
That's a good point. And I guess for me, there's like people give it 5 or 15 years before the dollar finally collapses, and you're going to have a lot of that.
Yeah.
And everybody.
I mean, the question is, what's the straw going to be that breaks the camel's back?
Right. And for me, I want to prevent it. For me, I have a lot of friends and family here. I can't family get hurt or injured or worse, be murdered. Right. So. Right now we have a good head start 5 years before people start projecting that the beginning where the dollar is going to start to collapse. But we can still spread these ideas further out there so people can start thinking free market solutions, thinking outside of the monopolized box that we're supposed to. Like I was studying criminal justice here, and you're only allowed to think within that monopoly law.
Sure.
Not allowed to think of polycentric legal systems. So to kind of push these ideas forward so we can get ready for the transition, it doesn't have to be violent. It can be very peaceful because we're already living it today. It doesn't have to go. Like you can look at Bitcoin, for example, digital currency. Have you heard of it?
Yeah.
You have? Okay. So that's sure. All right. Great. So that's one great example, anarcho cryptocurrency. Bitcoin's not going to throw you into a cage or compete with them. But there was a guy who did try to compete with the U.S. dollar a couple years ago with the Liberty dollar. IRS came in, seized his assets, threw him in a cage. Right.
Sure.
So I don't know what's going to look up here. It's going to look a lot better, at least with real sustainability, with real value.
Okay, well, great.
Yeah, well, my name is Cal.
Interesting to talk to you.
You too, man. Take good care. And so that's the hidden violence behind the matrix, behind this organization, behind government, and that only knows how to solve problems the one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems versus the plurality of nonviolent solutions that you and I already share.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, obviously the government is going to try to instill some sort of, I don't know, maybe, yeah, obviously superior mindset and like pretentious in some way. But I think also to some extent, it's like, depends on the person. And like, obviously there needs to be some sort of protection or whatnot. Obviously cannabis, pot and weed, it's like, it's not innocuous, but it's just like, come on, man, like mind your business. Like I can just chill out for a little bit. Like, is it going to affect you in the long run?
Who's the victim here?
Yeah, I know. And then I think like with other aspects too, I think it's, yeah, pot smoking obviously differs a lot from burglary and murder and everything, but it depends on the thing.
Yeah, but you're bringing a good point.
Don't get caught. Like, I think it's like, you have to be smart enough to hide your own things, not be conspicuous, but also like, it comes down to the person itself. Like, if you're immoral or irrational in some sort of way and going about things, it's gonna catch up to you.
Yeah.
I believe in karma and I do think it will eventually catch up to you. But I think maybe the severity of some punishments that they have for one thing, pot, regardless of what it might be, should without a doubt be at a different scale than arson and just other things. Like and holding people against their will, like habeas corpus, all that stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm still bringing a good point. All right, that's great. And that's pretty much the direction I want to go. Right? Unfortunately, with government, though, they can only force the majority of preference onto everyone in a geographic region against the minority, whether they agree or disagree or not. Right? Mm-hmm. And that's what government is. They have a monopoly, like we're talking about security. They have a monopoly on security.
Yeah.
They have a monopoly on courts, on judges, on security, on roads, on currency, first class mail. You don't have the freedom to unsubscribe, to cancel, or even have the freedom to compete against those services. That's not going to be harmful and abusive to the consumer, right? So outside the government, so like the point I'm trying to say in this moral position that you and I already share against using violence to solve problems, that's called anarchy.
Yeah.
Like in science, anions and cations. An means without, archy means rulers. Like monarchy, one political ruler, anarchy means without political rulers.
Yeah.
We can still have rules. We just don't need strangers arbitrarily dictating how best to decide our lives should be lived.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you recognize they also have a monopoly on law. Yeah. So outside of the monopoly, we can have a polycentric legal system. You can have an apartment complex that's 420 friendly. Great. One across the street that's not. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that's pretty much what everybody wants. Uh-huh. They just don't want those preferences on their particular property.
Uh-huh.
Right? So outside government, you'll find rich, diverse communities all around us with different preferences catering to different individuals.
Mm-hmm.
None of this political warfare that you see, you know, you're a Republican, I'm a Democrat, so trying to compete and trying to get that seat of power at the government.
Yeah.
But without it, there's nothing to compete, there's nothing to bribe.
Yeah.
You know, you're content with your own life, you're content with that community.
Yeah.
You don't want cannabis? Great, I'm going to enforce it on you, right?
Yeah. No, I know, it's like the Republicans and Democrats, like you said, you don't have to be just butting heads all the time and whatnot, you don't have to have different opinions. If you like what the other person's saying, it's persuasive, and you just meet an understanding, then you go ahead, build it together, and like, even though you might not agree with somebody, this might be discord, I think that like, you have to look out for what's best, I guess, for the overall group and whatnot. You can have your opinions and whatnot, but just think out from different perspectives, and as cliche as it sounds, like look, step in someone else's shoes.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. And it's difficult to do that when sometimes I think you still feel in the constant threat that the moment the other position, political class, gets that power, they will force their preference on you.
Mm-hmm.
We're part of an organization called Liberate RVA, non-political. Pretty much just turn to our community and turn away from government.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
So what if they legalize it tomorrow?
Yeah.
How long did that take?
Yeah.
75 years is not a measure of success to gain one scrap of our freedom for a plant, but to have lost so many others in the same amount of time.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I want real freedom in my lifetime. I don't want to have to beg for something that was rightfully mine to begin with.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So that's what we're advocating here, a free and voluntary society, communities of preferences.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, cool. Well, my name is Cal.
Aiden.
Aiden, pleasure to meet you, Aiden.
Indeed. Thanks a lot, yeah.